From the studios of Foxborough Cable Access, located in the center of Foxborough, Massachusetts, you are watching Around Foxborough.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jared Craig, and I'll be your host today for Around Foxborough. We have a very special guest with us today. His name is Herbie Mack. He hosts the podcast. It's called the Just Believe podcast. There's videos. You can find him on Instagram. This podcast is really insightful. Herbie's a suicide survivor and is doing, you know, a lot of work with destigmatizing mental health issues in our country, well, around the world, but primarily in our country. And I think it's going to be a great conversation today. We were just chatting a little bit before we started this, and I said, I just want this to feel like a conversation. And he said, that's how I run my podcasts. And it really feels that way. If you get a chance to check out his podcast, please do. You can get it on any podcast software, Apple Podcasts, Spotify. It's out there. You can just Google it too. Herbie Mack, welcome to the show. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. This is an honor, man.
Yeah, you're great. I really, truly appreciate the work that you're doing. I know that you have quite a story yourself. And if you feel comfortable sharing any of that with us at this time, I'd love to get your story and then maybe ask you a little bit about how that influences the work that you do.
Sure, no problem. My story started pretty much when I was in high school. It's about 14, 15. I had a sister who died from brain cancer. And I didn't really know how to respond. You know, when you're a teenager, nobody really can teach you how to share your emotions. And me being a male, and all the males that I looked up to, they always told me to suppress my emotions. Don't cry. Don't do any of that. And I was so confused and just like thrown off. And my behavior changed in high school. I wasn't really talking to too many people. I wasn't really responding to anybody. I was just like lost because I lost a sibling and I didn't know how to deal with it. And I didn't know how to talk to my parents about it. And, you know, on my parents on the outside, like looking in, they change. Obviously, like no one wants to bury a child. And my grades just went down. Like I went from probably like a C, B to straight Fs. And not because I was slow or anything, I was just checked out mentally. And it just led me to depression. And I was like depressed for a few years until one day my grandmother called me and she was like, hey, you need to snap out of it. I know you lost your sister and whatnot, but you know, you have to push through this and graduate. You got a chance to do something I haven't done. And I never knew that about my grandmother's, but it was weird that she knew something was wrong with me. My parents didn't really know, you know, they was in their own little world. And that conversation had me look up the word depressed. I was like, what is depressed? What is that? What is mental health? What is this? Because during this time, Google and YouTube and everything is not around, you know? So it was like, oh, okay, cool. And the idea of me going to see a therapist or counselor or something like that was not even a part of let's go see a therapist to see what's wrong with you. It's more of, hey, you be okay, man up and toughen up and push through this. I'm originally from the Bronx, by the way. So in the Bronx area that I lived in, nobody was talking about therapists or anything like that. My grandmother being the first one to reach out to me inspired me to get my life together and graduate. So I took up day school, night school, summer school, all types of school because I was so far behind and I wanted to graduate just to show her my thanks for her reaching out to me. Afterwards I graduated and I really felt like the relationship with my grandmother, her realizing that I had depression and really coaching me through it. I was like, okay, well, what's next? Let me go get a job. And I got a job. And then after I got this job, I was helping my mom out with my other sister. So I'm like, look, it's like 2-3 in the morning and I was in the middle of a shootout, right? And I'm just coming home from work, minding my business. And these two gang members are in front of my building and just arguing. And after they started shooting instantly, it's three of us out there. So I run into the building and, you know, I'm running up the stairs, tripping up the stairs and trying to lose this guy because they're chasing me. They thinking that I'm part of this equation. They don't realize it's a third innocent bystander. So after that, like I go in and out, lose one guy. I run into the other guy and they just threatened to both kill me. Luckily, they never really saw me. They just heard the footsteps and I was able to dodge them. And I got into my apartment safe. Instantly, I called like my girlfriend. She was in Tampa where I'm at now. And she was like, hey, can we, I told her the situation. She's like, hey, just save some money up and just come out to Tampa. Let's try to get you out this situation. You know, I'm about to die before I even turn 21. This is not the life I chose. So saved up money. And nobody tells you when you're like 18, 19, wherever you go, your problems come with you. So even though I left the Bronx and I'm in a whole different state, the problems of everything that I had built up kept occurring. And it was rough for me. So I did what any other, like, you know, college kid would do. I started drinking, and the drinking led into like a rabbit hole that I wasn't prepared for, right? I was not only drinking socially, I'm actually drinking more and more to numb the pain, the hurt, because I didn't know how to express myself. And I struggled with that for years, not gonna lie, right? And then one day I finally decided, okay, I'm tired of the hangovers. I'm tired of smelling like, you know, the whiskey, the rum, the Hennessy. I'm just tired of just smelling like it. And I realized I had an addiction and I'm not my addiction. Let me actually push through this. So I decided to like really lock in, focus, let me go to college. And as I go to college and I started making something of myself and I kept having the demons and I was like, okay, you know what? I'm actually going to control this, right? I really want to make something of myself. I didn't come this far for nothing. And I finally graduated. And after I graduated, my family never came down to see me. And I thought like, oh, you know, out of sight, out of mind type of thing. But I was like, you know, this is my big graduation. I didn't get a chance to walk in high school because I was so far behind that they just like shipped my diploma. Now I finally get to walk. I have the good grades and they didn't come down. And that triggered my depression so much because it was just like, man, I worked so hard. I wanted them to see this moment. It wasn't the fact of, you know, like I just didn't feel like I was important, you know? Yeah. So for me, I was just like, man, this hurt. Like, you know, they didn't reach out to during my sister's death. They didn't really reach out when I moved to Tampa. Now they didn't reach out to when I got the cap, the gown, and getting the certificate and ready to celebrate. Like, you know, this is like the championship. And it was rough for me. It took me down a rabbit hole. I started drinking more. My depression was heavy, where I started having suicidal ideation, the thoughts and everything, and the attempts. And for some reason, man, so like the girlfriend that I came to move with, I had broken up with her because my demons was too much and I didn't want to reflect them on her. She didn't understand. Now that like we're older, she gets it. So anyway, this one day she comes knocking on my door and I had no idea. And I open the door and I see her face and she's like, why do you look like that? Why do you smell like that? And I just reeked of like depression and alcohol. She could tell. So for the first time in my life as a man, as a person, I actually decided to lean in and tell her my emotions, right? Like, let me stop holding on and try to be so strong. And it was rough, you know, telling her that I tried to attempt suicide multiple times in a row, but that led to the breakthrough of her, hey, call the suicide lifeline number, let's go get you the help and whatnot. And that was great. You know, the whole time in my life, I thought asking for help was a sign of weakness, but it's actually a sign of strength. And me reaching out to the suicide lifeline number actually gave me some hope, right? And I never forget the young lady that I was speaking to, who was the counselor at the time. She was like, hey, on a scale of 1 to 10, how do you feel by yourself right now? And I was vulnerable for the first time ever. And I was just like a -5. For the first time in my life, I'm by myself and I don't trust myself by myself. Why is that? You know, because nobody never taught me mental health, how to take care of it, how to own it, or anything like that. So she recommended that I check myself into a mental health center, which I did. It was a gift. It was a curse. It was a gift because I was able to learn coping methods, speak to people who understood what I was going through, because I didn't know how to like harness all this emotion. But it was a curse because the psychiatrist there was, he was a horrible psychiatrist. That's the only way I could say. It was a disconnect. You know, as far as like language, like we all have a language barrier, how we like to be, you know, receive communication.
Absolutely.
And for him, he didn't look at me as a person. He looked more as if I was just a number, right? Like, oh, hey, take this and go out your day. You'll be out of here soon.
And meaning he prescribed. He prescribed.
Oh, dude, I never saw a pen to a paper so fast, right? Like he read my file based off the nurses interviewing me. And, you know, they have two people interviewing you because they don't know how you're going to react. They don't know if you're like, you know, they don't know if you have like any chemical balance or anything like that. Mm-hmm. So for him, he read it and he's just like, look, take this. And I challenged him. I was like, hey, I didn't come here for any drugs or anything like that. Like, if I wanted that, there's also resources that I can get that from. I actually came here to learn how to handle this emotions, learn how to deal with what I'm dealing with. And for him, he was upset by it. So like, he looked at my file again, and before he started insulting me, he looked around because there's like two cameras. There's one in the front, one in the back. And he was just like, oh, okay, you're from the Bronx. So I know people from the Bronx have like a low IQ. They're not really that bright and all that. And I was just like, oh, okay. So we're going to go down this path, right? So I'm originally from New York. Look where you're at. So you already know we have the tough skin. So if you're going to insult me, don't insult me. Insult my mom or something like that to get me riled up. Insult but he didn't know. Yeah. Insult the Knicks, right? Like, get me mad. I'm a huge Knicks fan. Insult them. And but you know what? I learned being from the Bronx to have a tough skin. So that didn't faze me because I knew he wanted to get a reaction out of me. And before I checked myself and I read all the paperwork, and when you volunteer yourself, they give you 72 hours to reevaluate you to see how you're doing. And based off the 72 hours, if you're not doing so well, they hold you longer until they see you, you know, have some sort of progress. So I was just like, okay, this is the part that he's testing me. So if I react and jump on him and pound him out, I'm going to be here longer than the 3 days that I need to be here. Okay. I didn't sign up for that. I came here for the proper help. Clearly, we're not speaking the same language. I'm going to go to the nurses that we already built a rapport. They've been teaching me coping methods and teaching me how to express myself, right? Because I didn't have a chemical imbalance. I just had a moment where life was just too much for me, and I made a irrational decision.
And did you know, were you aware enough to know that you didn't have a chemical imbalance? Or did someone have to tell you that?
I knew. I knew. You know, at a certain point in life, you know who you are, right? And I knew, like, I didn't have, I just had too much emotion buildup from years, you know, from like, you know, 10, 15 years of just buildup. And I never had any conversations about the pain and trauma that I was going through. So every time something happened that was negative to me, I'll just like, you know, try to suck it up and okay, I'm good. I'm strong. Like, you know, yeah, I'm good. And that's unhealthy. But I never, you know, I told you every male was telling me to bottle up all my emotions. So I had so much buildup that I had to learn how to release emotions. And thankfully I had the connection with the nurse, right? They gave me like a notebook and a pencil. And I started writing. And I was able to write and understand what went wrong. Oh, okay, this went wrong. This is where I can pick myself up. It was something that my basketball coach in high school taught me, right? He always used to ask me, hey, what's the weakest point of your game? And, you know, when you're 14, 15, you don't know. You're like, dude, you're the coach. You tell me. Right. But he broke it down so simple for me. He said, if you can learn the weakest points of your game, your opponent can never stop you. So I had to use this experience as basketball, which I'm very, like, as you can see, I love a lot, because basketball was one of my coping methods to really balance me out. So I wrote down all the hurt. And I identified what things was going wrong in my life, the turning point, the disconnect between my parents and I, the disconnect between me, right? Mm-hmm. You know, I'm out here sitting here searching for love and trying to love everyone else, but instead I wasn't loving myself. And after this time, I'm like, man, you know, I finally get able to leave the place and the facility, and I'm home and I'm back at this place where I try to attempt suicide. And I would never... I'm not going to lie to you. I Google how to love yourself because no one taught me how to love myself. And I started positive affirmations, writing more, right? Self-talk, right? It's funny because my podcast is named the Just Believe Podcast. And it's for a reason. I got a marker. I went to Walmart. I bought a marker. And my apartment complex probably hate me. And I put Just Believe in the mirror. I can get over this depression if I just believe. And I had to do certain things to believe in myself, right? Okay, I'm not going to drink anymore. Why? Because when I drink, I turn into the Incredible Hulk. I can't handle the Hulk. Let me chill out, you know? Yeah. So, but in order not to drink, I got to stop hanging out with certain friends. Not because they're bad friends. They're just putting me in bad situations where I won't win. I need to put myself in a situation where I can't win. So, hey, we're going to hang out. Cool. We can go to a baseball game. We can go to football games. We can do all that. But I'm not going to go to the bar with you to watch the game. I'm not going to go to the clubs with you to watch the games. I'm not going to go to the strip clubs or anything like that. I'm going to put myself in a situation, hey, I can handle myself in a baseball game. I can handle myself in a basketball game, a football game, because there's something there to distract me from instead of like, man, I need to get a drink, you know? So that's what I started doing. Started putting down the video games and picking up more books. Not just like self-help books, but just books in general to help me think out of the element that I was thinking in. Okay, cool. Let me start exercising more and doing that and holding myself accountable.
You see, you seem like one of these people that like have things figured out. Like you've gone through hell and you came out on the other side. And I wonder, what do you say to those people who aren't on the other side yet and are like looking down that like, I can't do that hard work of getting healthy mentally. Like how did you, or what advice do you give to those people that have to sort of, I don't know, pull themselves out of it? You know, what do you say to those people?
So what I was doing, and what somebody else is probably listening or watching this is doing, is, you know how you have a goal of a big goal, like, hey man, this year I'm going to go to Paris. Instead, I made small goals, because small goals are still goals, right? So like, I live in a state where they have beautiful beaches. I wasn't going to the beach at all. So I set a small goal. This year, I'm going to go to the beach. Instead of something that's like, man, I'm going to work my tail off to go on vacation, it's something that's realistic. And I started, the smaller the goals are, the more you can achieve it. Because when you don't achieve that big goal, you feel defeated. So I started making small goals and checking it off. Okay, I'm going to go to the beach. Okay, I'm going to work out once a week. Just once. I'm not just trying to say I got to work out every day, but just once a week. And don't even have to be a full body workout or anything. Let me just get a 2-mile walk in. Let me pick up a book. I don't have to read the entire book, but let me read a chapter, right? And let me give myself something to pat myself on the back. So when I read a chapter of a book, okay, I'm going to pick out. I'm going to have my ice cream, man. I'm going to go get a milkshake or something, you know, so I can reward myself. And started building myself up there. It wasn't, to be honest with you, it took me about 2.5 years to learn how to heal. I'm still healing. It's not something that's a life thing. But I also put myself in positions to understand, like, I'm not going to achieve everything all at once, and it's okay. Stop putting the pressure on yourself to try to achieve everything at once. Let me achieve the small goal and build up and build up and build up.
Are you still actively going to therapy?
No, the crazy part, I never did therapy.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, interesting. I never did therapy. I self-healed because I couldn't afford therapy. During this time, like, you know, we didn't have the access of like now, like, I hate to say this, but the pandemic led to a lot of therapists, hey, we have free sessions or lower sessions than ever. So I did everything naturally. Like healing, writing is one of my biggest methods that I use to help me understand. You know, have you ever been in the car and somebody like cut you off and you're mad? And like, I used to carry that all the time. Like, I used to be home like, man, I can't believe this person cut me off. And I'm like, you know, Herbie, that happened like 8 hours ago.
That's heavy.
Why am I still mad about that? And then I started writing, and then it's something that I do, right? Like that instant of the person cutting me off. If I'm that mad about it, I would just write as fast as I can in my journal, rip out the page after I'm done, and tear it up. And guess what? I released that emotion. It's gone. I'm not holding on to it.
Yeah, that's beautiful. If I may ask you, one of the things that I feel like you talk about a lot, at least from what I've been able to see, is like society's view of masculinity and manliness. And how did that impact your mental health? We talked a little bit about you can't express those things. You got to keep them bottled up.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, just the actual question that I'm dancing around is like, how did you feel comfortable enough to not only deal with that, but make a podcast where you're publicly talking about your emotions?
For me, that messed me up mentally. That was my downfall of trying to hold on to things, trying to show the world I'm strong enough. And it's like, if you like constantly have like junk and you're sweeping all your junk into the closet, at some point it's going to be too much junk for that closet to hold and it's all going to come out. So for me, I was just like, I want to talk about it. I went on Instagram after I was like kind of comfortable talking about mental health, but not really. So I went on Instagram and I was looking for people that was talking about it. And during this time, like when I searched it up of like mental health and suicide prevention, it was a lot of older white women who was somewhere between like 40 to like 60, right? And their content is good. But then for me, I was like, okay, well, where are the guys? And then the guys that was talking about it wasn't really relatable to me. Like, you know, you would get the term if I talk about like Tom Brady and the Super Bowl of me walking. That was my Tom Brady moment. Felt, but your some people, yeah, but some people may not understand that, right? They might be like, why is he talking? But that's how big of the moment is, or you know. So I was just like, you know what? Let me be the face of it, because as guys, you know, when it comes to mental health, especially like suicide, when people are dying by suicide, males are higher than females, right? That's because we don't know how to express ourselves. We feel like as guys, we have to carry all the whole burden of the family, of everything. No, we're human. So we have to talk about
it. If I'm not feeling right, it's something wrong with me, not something wrong with everyone else and how we've all constructed ourselves, right?
Exactly.
Oh, that's fascinating. I have a friend who would say that like we go to the gym to work on our bodies. We should be able to have a space where we work on our mental health too. And I feel like you've done a good job of creating that, where even just listening to a couple of your podcasts in the last few days, it's been healthy for me to just hear that, you know? And so I was wondering if you have a favorite guest, or for those people who might be listening and haven't heard your podcast, is there someone you would recommend that we listen to start off with?
Oh man.
I'll put a plug in that Jury Love, who also hosts this show, was on your podcast recently.
Yes.
I thought she had a really good program too.
Yeah. Oh yes. Yes. You know what? It's going to be weird that I'm going to say this, right? Because like, you know, it's guys based, but the episode for me that really changed my perspective of like really being a voice was Sarah Beasley. We talked about her daughter who died by suicide at the age of 19. And she went through trauma. She was, unfortunately, she got raped by an acquaintance, right? And I went out and I reached out to Sarah too, because I read her story off of her profile, not in her profile, but her website. And I was just like, man, we don't really talk about this as far as like kids are dying by it. And I was really touched by it because my mental health like challenge started out in high school. And the mom caught it, realized that her daughter needed therapy and all that. And they went through it, but it still wasn't enough for her daughter. She still felt like the pressure of life was too much. She felt like, you know, she was just tainted. That episode really changed my perspective on it. And then I have another episode that also helped me out as well. And it's when I interviewed Dr. Carlos Garcia. He's a therapist as well. Now, my podcast, I try to balance it out. I advocate for people to go to therapy, even though I haven't went to therapy, because sometimes it might be too much for a person. I wish I could afford therapy during that time, because I probably would have held up my process of healing. But being able to talk to the pros, as I call them, helps out so much, because they can guide you in the direction that you need to go in.
That's great. Feels to me a little bit like your podcast is maybe, I don't mean to put it words in your mouth, but it might be a form of therapy for you, because you get to sort of explore all these ideas. How'd you come up with the idea for a podcast? Why was that the right way to go about getting your ideas out there?
So, you know, when I was on Instagram, I was doing daily videos, and I did a couple of podcasts prior to that. And I was just like, man, I don't really see people talking about mental health, especially guys talking about mental health, but not just me, right? Like I look at the stigma of mental health as if it's Thanos, right? Why can't I be one of the Avengers? Not saying that I can sit down and break the stigma myself. I'd be a fool to think that. But I can interview people who can talk about their challenges or even their crisis or whatnot, to show people that it doesn't matter if you're Black, white, purple, Asian, it doesn't matter. It's a human thing that we just need to break. Like, as you said, prior to it, we normalize talking about going to the gym and losing weight every January. Why can't we normalize talking about just going to therapy?
Absolutely. A big thing that I think too has come across in the last year is this increased isolation. People are obviously forced to stay by themselves inside. Have you found that you need to reach out to people more, or you need people to reach out to you more? Any advice on that?
Yeah. So for the, like, when lockdown first happened, you know, I reached out to a couple of people to make sure that they're cool. But then I had to learn how to reach out to myself, right? Everything had my attention, Instagram, Facebook, Netflix, right? And we're so quick to give other people our attention, but I had to learn how to give myself my own attention.
Yeah, that's great. Herbie, that's just about all the time that we have. I know you're also a life coach too, so I wanted to get that in there. Where can people find you if they're interested in learning more about you or your services?
Yeah, sure. You can go to herbiemack.com. You can reach out to me there. I have my email and everything, or you can follow me on Instagram, Facebook at Herbie Mack. And that's it, man.
Really appreciate it. Thanks for being so candid with your story and telling us all about it. Really appreciate you being here today. Thanks for your time. Again, this is Herbie Mack. His podcast is the Just Believe podcast. I'm Jared Craig from around Foxborough. We have a few thank yous. I want to thank Michael Weber, our executive director, Jerry Love, the executive producer, Paul Beck, our director, Joshua Lovering, our editor, and Lauren Bittar, our master control operator. I'm Jared Craig, again, here with Herbie Mack. Thanks so much for being here. We'll talk to you soon.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Herbie.
Bye.
Bye.